A couple of years ago, a small group of American lawyers headed by Telford Taylor hit on the idea of attempting to help 20 imprisoned Russians, 18 Jews, 2 Gentiles, strictly within the framework of Soviet law. It is not widely known, but in fact there are laws in the Soviet Union, and occasionally they are observed. Indeed, the much heralded Constitution of 1936 probably lists more human rights than any constitution in the world. The problem being, of course, that the Constitution is of no particular use to Soviet citizens who incur official displeasure. Mr. Taylor and his associates carefully reconstructed the trials of these 20 Soviet citizens whose common offense was their petition for emigration permits, and after their considerable effort, were forced finally to give up. It is all recorded in Mr. Taylor's new book, just published, called Courts of Terror, Soviet Criminal Justice and Jewish Emigration. The book contains a very useful appendix of provisions of Soviet law, of which read as though they had been written by John Stuart Mill. Telford Taylor was a natural to head up this committee because he had served as associate counsel during the Nuremberg prosecutions of the Nazi war criminals. He had come to know as a colleague the Soviet member Roman Rudenko. Now Roman Rudenko serves as, quote, procurator of the Soviet Union, a position roughly comparable to our Attorney General. While in Moscow pleading the case of the Jewish prisoners, Mr. Taylor renewed his acquaintance with procurator Rudenko, alas, to no avail. Apart from his knowledge of Rudenko, Telford Taylor is a skilled legal scholar, a professor of law at Columbia, who served as an intelligence officer during the war, reaching finally the rank of general, and who has written a number of books, including Grand Inquest and Nuremberg and Vietnam, wherein he played with the thesis that the United States was guilty of war crimes under the Nuremberg and Yamashita precedents. I should like to discuss with Mr. Taylor first his experiences in the Soviet Union and the theoretical advisability then of such reactions as the Jackson Amendment. And I begin by asking him, is a foreigner permitted to practice law inside the Soviet Union, or was your expeditionary force really engaged in something other than the practice of law?
A foreigner is not allowed to practice law in the formal sense. That is to say, the petitions we submitted were not made part of the formal court records. I suppose that would be here too, because admission to the bar is a requisite in both places. But there as here, there are discretionary powers in some of the high officials. They can receive information from any source. The Procurator General, unlike our Attorney General, has the power to what they call protest judgments of the courts. He can say that he finds errors in them and call for their reconsideration.
A call or required?
Require. Mm-hmm. He can require their reconsideration. And what we were doing was submitting to him information which he could accept or reject in his discretion in the hope that he would use that to protest these judgments and reconsider them.
Does he give opinions?
Well, he can, but he didn't. Mm-hmm. I'd like to go back to one thing you said in your introductory remarks, which was that we were forced to give up. That's not really the right way to put it. We did have to change our tactics. The initial thought here was that if we could make a strong showing under Soviet law, the combination of pride, shame, dislike of getting an unpleasant image, it didn't lead us to expect they would ever admit error, but they might say yes, say no, but do yes. That is, there might be some actual concessions to these people. That was what we were initially hoping for. That did not work out.
Of course, in due course, they're going to be released anyway, since their terms went for that long.
15 years is a mighty long time, as they say in the old song. So that a number of them convicted in 1970 won't be out till 1985, and there's no time off for good behavior as there is here. So long sentences mean long sentences. We have had some slight success out of it. I mean, in one of our cases, we, I think, succeeded in getting a release ahead of schedule, a 5-year term where the man was released after 2. But generally speaking, it would be correct to say that we didn't achieve immediate results. However, the petitions are just one step in a course of action which we hope in the long run may have some good effects.
Would you describe, there are several cases described in the book which would serve these purposes, but would you give an example of one in which the frame-up was most conspicuous?
Mm-hmm. Some of them are frame-ups, some of them are not frame-ups, but involve the distortion of the law to achieve a more drastic result. A frame-up, a good example, would be this case that I spoke of where we did achieve some success. A carpenter in the town of Derbent, which is a small city by the Caspian Sea, quite remote. Quite a large Jewish population, but there had not up to this point been any tendency to emigrate from Derbent. The carpenter and his family, I think, sharing the general revival of interest in Judaism, which the 1967 war brought about, put in for immigration permits. The result was the carpenter was charged with overcharging for his carpenter services. And
everybody would be guilty of that here, wouldn't they?
Yes, and most of them there too, as a matter of fact. The so-called second economy is, we'll come to that later. But anyhow, he was brought up on these charges.
Only after the immigration permit had been solicited?
Only after it had been solicited, yes. He never got it, as a matter of fact. But he was tried, and by a strange coincidence, one of the judges on the trial was Jewish and was later allowed to emigrate. We found her in Israel, and she gave us an affidavit which said in substance as follows, that there was no evidence of his overcharging. All the witnesses against him that the government called denied it. She was directed by the presiding judge to go to him and say that if he would drop his desire to emigrate, they would abandon the charges against him. That's an example of a case where the whole thing is a fabrication.
And would you say what Mr. Rudenko said when you accosted him with that?
It was impossible to engage Mr. Rudenko in what you would call a lawyer-to-lawyer discussion of the issues. And as a matter of fact, when I saw him, it was before we had the Pinkasov case evidence that was submitted later. But I never got into the discussion of particular cases other than one. And let me come back, therefore, to an example of the other kind, where it isn't a fabricated case, but the thing is distorted to produce a result they want. The famous so-called Leningrad hijacking of 1970.
The treason thing.
The treason thing, yes. Well, that was undeniably criminal. It was a preparation for an attempt to hijack. They had indeed taken precautions to avoid loss of life, but still it was criminal by anybody's law. But they had no law against hijacking, no statute against hijacking. And desiring to impose a heavy sentence, they indicted them for treason, which it certainly was not. Treason under Soviet laws, as under ours, requires an intent to injure the security of the state. And there is no indication of that. This is purely an effort to get out of the Soviet Union and go to Israel. This resulted initially in death sentences. And here, I think, is a good example of the fact that the pressure can achieve some results. There was a very wide world outcry against these death sentences, and on appeal, those were commuted to 15 years. Now, that's an example of a case where, although there is a criminal element in it, in order to achieve heavier penalties and strike more fear into others who would want to emigrate, the law is simply distorted and set aside to achieve the result they want. And of course, if I may just add one other thing.
We have the death penalty for hijacking, don't we, theoretically?
Theoretically, it would apply to whether it's ever imposed or not, but the statute authorizes it. Yes, and for kidnapping if death results and that sort of thing, yes, sure. What I was going to say is that the unfair quality of these trials is no accident. I honestly don't know how trials go in the Soviet Union in cases where there is no strong state interest, where it's an ordinary thing. But they certainly make these trials unfair because these are more frightening than fair trials. If a person who wants to emigrate knows that if he gets in trouble with the law, it's all up, conviction is certain, guarantees are going to be set aside, this is very much more of a threat to others than the possibility of a fair trial. So it serves a state purpose to do them this way.
Yes, it does. When you say that you have no knowledge of the workings of Soviet law in cases in which the interest of the state is not involved.
Very minimal, yeah.
Is it because that evidence is not available? I know that one of your colleagues at Columbia is a specialist in the matter. In fact, they sent him over, you remember, to help spring the Yale professor who was arrested on phony charges.
I meant I had no personal knowledge.
Yeah.
I have, of course, talked to John Hazard and Harold
Hazard,
Berman and other experts in the area, and the general impression I've gotten from them is that although there is here, there may be local influences that distort the judicial process, that it doesn't work too badly as long as there is no important state interest involved. Mm-hmm. But this is hearsay from them, and I couldn't support that with any personal experience.
Yeah, yeah. All right, now let's get into the question, if you will, of how in fact to generate pressure. You say now that the result of your actions and the result of your book will be to cause shame and humiliation, such as might work for the benefit of the individual aggrieved parties and of the class of people who stand to be persecuted.
To be victimized this
way. Or victimized the same way. How ought our society to be most useful in generating that pressure? Do you think, for instance, that your book should be reviewed in Radio Liberty, Radio Free Europe, Voice of America, in order to drive home the point that these persecutions and victimizations continue?
I think this is one of many ways that, that this could be done. My own feeling is that the kind of pressure that they react to most sharply is pressure from people who visit the Soviet Union. Of course, even the ordinary tourist who goes to Soviet Union is taken around most everywhere by an in-tourist guide. I haven't the slightest doubt that the in-tourist guides are, in a sense, state agents, that they report back what are the Americans talking about, what are the French talking about. They constantly feed information. Then businessmen go and associate with the Soviet officials in factories and commercial enterprises and so forth. Congressmen go to visit the Soviet Union. A great many people go for a great variety of purposes, and the more people who are informed about this and who pester the daylights out of their hosts and others and talk about this and confront them with questions which they are unable to answer and which reflect unfavorably on their system and their ways, I think this is the sort of pressure which in the long run may have some effects.
Well, I understand the theory of what you say. While questioning the practicality of it, I've been there a few times, and it seems to me that most conversations with representatives of the state, and practically everyone one talks to as a tourist or even as a visiting official, is a representative of the state, they handle quite easily by simply denying. They would undoubtedly say that Telford Taylor made up a whole lot of stuff, that he intended to discredit the Soviet system, that there was a conspiracy to defame, and so on and so forth. The same kind of stuff they say in the United Nations. Now, I think it's unreasonable to suppose that American tourists go over there and can be equipped to handle these arguments. Even if you lecture in the Arbatov Institute, as I've done, you don't, and you're facing real pros, they nevertheless will cling to a particular line which becomes impenetrable, even as Rudenko, I'm sure, proved himself in this book impenetrable.
There's much in what you say. I think these are basically questions of technique, and it's not all one way or all the other way. Not all Soviet citizens are immune to conversational approach. I quite agree again that most tourists, it would be difficult for them to know enough about it to answer detailed questions, but I don't think they'll usually have to. I think usually they're the people they're talking to there will be even less informed than they are. Of course, that's only one way of doing it, and the ways you suggest, and awareness through diplomatic sources that a book is being circulated and discussed is another way, too. The reason that we included in these appendices with petitions and so forth is because it seems to me the book ought to be perhaps of more interest to professionally to lawyers than to the general public even. I mean, the book is about one-third narrative, which I hope is lucid and reasonably interesting, but the appendices were put in there so that people interested in the techniques of this could see how it was done.
What the sources are, yeah.
Yes.
Sure, sure. Well, but let me ask you a very direct question because it has to do with matters of public policy. Mm-hmm. Do you or do you not believe that your book should in effect be serialized over Radio Free Europe and over Radio Liberty, in order to advise Soviet citizens of the documented outrages of Soviet criminal practice?
If it would accomplish that purpose, I would certainly say yes. I don't know myself the extent to which those media are effective, but the tone of your question suggests that you think maybe they would be.
Well,
if that would be so, I would be very much for it, yes.
Certainly the poet Vasnovsky said that everything he knew about the workings of the West, he himself had gotten from Radio
mm-hmm.
Liberty.
Yeah.
And we know, of course, that Solzhenitsyn, how heavily he relied on it.
There is
a school of thought.
Ceasing to jam as much now,
that's right.
Too.
You know, well, they stopped jamming since Helsinki.
Yeah.
But it may be they ceased to jam because at about the same time we ceased to say anything very offensive.
That I didn't know.
Well, there is certainly a school of thought that finds it a little bit raucous for us to dwell on Soviet incivilities. Do you count yourself as a member of that school? Obviously not in your book.
No, I can't see why. A lot of people have asked me whether this wasn't an unwarranted intervention in Soviet legal affairs. I mean, that question has been put to me on other occasions when this has been publicly discussed. But the fact is, you know, that that any trial which touches deep political issues becomes an international matter. The Dreyfus trial.
Sure.
The public trials in this country, the Chicago 7, Angela Davis.
The foreigners didn't stay out of Sacco Vanzetti.
Certainly not. Certainly not. Mm. I don't think there's anything improper, unprecedented, or, as you put it, raucous about that. Of course, there might be a raucous way of doing it, mm-hmm. but it seems to me it should be done objectively and as accurately as possible and as forcefully. And yes, I'd be all for the what you suggest.
Okay, let's move up the ladder.
Yeah.
Do you favor the Jackson Amendment, which of course is the most clear-cut formal protest against policies that seek to victimize precisely this class of people?
Yeah. I'll have to enter a disclaimer at the beginning that that my role in this was a strictly legal one, and I don't consider myself an expert on these political overtones of the matter, but I do have this feeling that, again, my attitude is a little bit one of cold-blooded practicality. Is this likely to accomplish the purpose in mind? If the Jackson Amendment would indeed have the result of ameliorating internal abuses in the Soviet Union, I would be all for it. I'm inclined to think, though, that overt political efforts to extract a quid pro quo don't work too well with strongly established governments that believe in their own internal policies, that they that governments are not so likely to yield to the bribes of money or grain or economic benefit if the thing is laid on the table and it becomes openly a deal.
So we shouldn't ban the purchase of chrome from Rhodesia?
I'm not sure whether the Rhodesian government would classify in the group that I just described as a government which is all that well set up and immune from those kinds
of
pressures.
Say South Africa, then.
Again, you're stretching my knowledge a little bit beyond where I like to answer
with confidence. You said strong government was your...
I'm trying to use a principle here, and I don't believe if the government feels sure of itself and attaches importance to what it's doing internally, that it will yield readily to the to what is really a quid pro quo notion. I'll trade you this for that.
Mm-hmm.
I think it has to be done more circumspectly and indirectly. But I do believe that there is a direct connection between between one's economic and political relations with another country and their internal conduct. That's so with us, it's so with every country, and the more the world has become one, the more these echoes of what goes on one place affect feeling and attitudes in the other.
Well, we know that Henry Kissinger, who worked very hard to defeat the Jackson Amendment on the grounds that it was an unwarranted interference in the domestic policies of another country, which policies, however despicable,
mm-hmm.
Were policies that we were simply not in a position to affect, has since made the point that Jewish emigration has declined since the Jackson Amendment, presumably as a result of Soviet resentment. The figures are down now to 25 or 30 a day, mm-hmm. though they were 3 or 4 times that 3 years ago. Question, has he been proved right, or do you think that Sakharov, who backed that amendment, is correct in saying that there are always going to be seizures, convulsions, reactions, when the West shows a firm hand, but that the strategic consequences of showing a strong hand are what the dissident class in Russia has to count on?
I think I'm a little bit of the latter school of thought. It's a very complicated question. I would never put the matter the way you say Kissinger did, that it would be an unwarranted interference for us to do this. The question for me would be, is it likely to prove effective in achieving what we're trying to bring about here?
I mean, you do believe in active interventionist policies. Let me ask you how you react to Fulbright's statement of the question. Here's where he put it. The United States has no proper quarrel with any country in the world, no matter how obnoxious its domestic policies, so long as it does not seek to export them.
I think it's very hard to buy a blanket proposition of that kind. I think that presupposes a sharp division, I mean walls between nations, which are much more porous, in fact, and much lower than Fulbright imagines when he puts it that way.
Well, you think in effect that it is built into an evil system that it is exported?
Yes.
Did Papa Doc export his brand of tyranny in any sense?
That's a kind of tiny base, but yes.
Where? Where?
Where what?
Where did Papa Doc export his evil policy?
Oh, well, I think the notion that a regime can persist, can last, and still do these things is a notion which tends to undermine the feeling that such regimes ought not to exist. Mm-hmm. Success breeds respect, fear of upsetting it, and therefore any area like that which is able to survive and keep going with very repressive policies is a threat to other areas, a psychological threat.
It's simply in virtue
when
of
I said it was a tiny base, I mean that is a pretty tiny example. But certainly the initial successes, military and political, of Nazi Germany fomented a fear and a tendency to give way throughout the world that were, I think, very, very unfortunate. And that would be so anywhere, whether the dictatorship is of the right or the left.
Well, George Kennan likes to quote from John Quincy Adams' inaugural address, the phrase, the American people are friends of liberty everywhere, but custodians only of their own. Would you class that as an isolationist statement in the sense in which we are discussing the matter?
It's not quite as abrupt as Fulbright's.
You said no proper quarrel.
It's a little bit more epigrammatic than meaningful, it seems to me. Custodians only of our own. Of course, we have political responsibility by domestic law only for our own. But I think we have the obligation to conduct foreign policy in a way which will be effective in spreading the ideals that the country stands for.
Well, in what sense, then, would you say that recent ventures in diplomacy in China have helped this ideal? Would you say that Mr. Nixon's trip to China helped to loosen the shackles by which the Chinese people are imprisoned? You said you wouldn't be permitted even to China, go to China and do what you do in the Soviet Union, would you?
Well, I honestly don't know. I honestly don't know. Well, I went to the Soviet Union hardly expecting to do what I did there. I don't have the advantage of knowing any former Chinese prosecutor. Maybe that's the real difference. I think it was because of that prior acquaintance that I was able to, so to speak, bust through the front door of the procuracy and get to see him. I doubt if I would have otherwise.
Well, you mean if you hadn't figured at all, you don't think that other American lawyers like Mr. Dershowitz and so on would have been able even to gather up the evidence that you gathered?
Well, we gathered most of the evidence in Israel, and
yeah,
that
I know,
we could
I know.
Do. But submit it and get it
but
on
examine
paper.
But examine the court records, of course they didn't exist.
Well, the court records may not exist, but you can't see them. I mean, it certainly isn't like it is here, where a court record is a public document. You can go in and look at it. Incidentally, it isn't in Britain either. You have to get court permission in Britain to go and look at the record. So these things are not uniform everywhere. But I think that was the factor, and I don't know anybody from China that would make that entree likely.
Yeah, but apart from that, is it not the case that our diplomatic overtures to China, to the extent that they are cordial, tend to subvert that hostility you think we ought to maintain towards the slave masters of the world?
Well, if what you're asking me is whether I think it's a good idea that we establish relations with China and have interchange of high personalities and low personalities visits, well, I think the answer to that is yes. Mm-hmm. I don't think the quarantine procedure is a very effective one.
I agree with you. I think we should
but
have had it with Hitler,
too. But if you're asking me whether Nixon's visit achieved anything in the way of liberalizing the interior of China, I very much doubt it. Mm-hmm. Whether a long progression of official visits and business visits and other things would in the long run have that effect, I suppose we've got to wait and find out.
Yeah. I'm interested really in exploring your statement that we want to see, quote, means of generating pressure. What are the means? What is the orchestration? We discussed bringing the news to Soviet citizens via our radio. We've discussed what we should or what we should or should not do with Jackson type amendments, where you tend to say no because they don't produce. On the other hand, you're not sure whether they mightn't produce in the long term.
That's right. And as a matter of fact, there is one stage at which we were holding up on making this project public, precisely because the Jackson Amendment was pending, and that phase when it appeared that there might be an arrangement made to drop the Jackson Amendment in return for some concessions about immigration, we hoped to get some benefit out of that for our our clients. But that didn't pan out either, and it was after that fell away that we decided to, so to speak, go public on the thing.
Well, what do you think our government might do that it hasn't done that could help such victims? If you want to exclude,
I don't believe there's very much that the official approach can do at the moment. There are other forces. I mean, this is one corner of an enormous web of relations and problems that that interact on each other. And at the moment, I don't myself see that government intervention, government protest on this thing is likely to have much result. I think, again, it's more the accumulation of an awareness on their part that this thing is giving them a bad image, that they can't tell in what ways it will come up to frustrate or disappoint them. Cause them to rethink whether it is worthwhile for them to be doing these things, whether the benefits that they think they are getting out of restricting immigration and handling these trials this way are at all sufficient to balance the wave of hostility and contempt that is generated by this kind of behavior.
Well, given the almost uniformly antagonistic attitude toward the Soviet Union of all Americans who go and spend any time there, does it therefore surprise you that they permit foreign correspondents to have certain freedom of travel there, which of course China does not? If they are indeed sensitive to world opinion, they must be sensitive to things like Hedrick Smith's book, The Russians. Would it therefore not follow that they should not permit foreign correspondents in Moscow if they were uniform in wanting to insulate themselves from this kind of criticism?
Well, I don't think they are uniform in that respect. I suppose they could insulate themselves more the way China does. They choose not to. Why this is, I suppose, would involve a much more extensive knowledge of Soviet society and politics than I have. But I believe that things do change, you know, and new generations grow up that don't take for granted what they're told. We have that experience here too, don't we? And I think there are pressures internally that they may figure that to allow the lid on the kettle to be light enough so it will bubble and let off some steam is in the long run wiser than to keep it on too tight. In the German army during the war, they had a thing called Ventilfrage, which was a device by which soldiers could send letters of complaint in. And this is rather unusual under the Nazi system, but their feeling was that a way to blow off steam and object and feel like a normal person was a safeguard of the system as a whole. I think it must be based on some estimate of what is in the long run best for Soviet security as they see it. Nor do I think that their officialdom is all alike. Russians, after all, are individuals. Some are more communist than others. And communism doesn't absorb the whole personality. There is a range of variety there which changes. And I guess I look at our effort, apart from our desire to help the immediate clients, as perhaps one thing which in the long run would move in that direction internally in the Soviet Union.
Well, you talked a moment ago about these 15-year sentences,
yeah,
with a kind of resignation. 15 years is a long time, and we all know the cliche about how in the long run we're all dead. What objective grounds are there for believing that during the period in which such efforts as your own have been mounted and cultural exchange has been stimulated and so on and so forth, any genuine progress has been made? We have Hedrick Smith now telling us that life is much worse now in terms of freedom than it was during 1957, after the 20th Congress declarations. Do you really visualize it as a situation in which there is mounting pressure on this totalitarian state to relax and be civil?
Fluctuating, and I would think over the whole course of years since 1920, mounting, yes. I've been to the Soviet Union, I guess, all in all 5 times. I went the first time in 1929, which was, of course, before the Stalin dictatorship was fixed. The standpoint of having fun and enjoying oneself there was much the most pleasant trip I had, because there was very little fear of foreigners. Conversation was relaxed. The whole thing was quite different from when I went back again in 1936, which was at the peak of the Stalin tyranny. And
was that an official trip?
Oh, no. I was just out of college at the in 1929.
I'm talking about 36.
36? Yeah. No, that wasn't an official trip either. Mm-hmm. No. I'm fond of Russian music and culture. I like Russians. I was interested in seeing the country. This was the only reason for going. But again, it was educating, because the contrast between 29 and 36 was so sharp and so apparent to even an uninstructed visitor like myself. I didn't go back again. I went back again briefly in 1938 for similar reasons, but then not again until I went on this trip in 1974. And
36 years later.
36 years later, yes. And it was about 26 years since I had seen Rudenko. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. He must be a very shrewd and endurate man. He's been in that position since 1952.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He came in with Khrushchev. He survived the passing of Khrushchev and is...
I thought you said 52.
Yeah, but he came in more or less with... He's a protege of Khrushchev.
I see. Mm-hmm.
Ukrainian, yes.
Mm-hmm. So this... The movement from 38 to 76 is hopeful, but
overall, yes. The demise of Stalin, the changes since then on the whole, have been more libertarian than totalitarian, I would say, yes. That is, the movement has been slightly that way.
But the recidivism of the last 8 or 10 years is built into the system or not built into the system?
Well, I guess it's built into the system in the sense that the system will react to outside events in a way which is not governed by a love for civil liberties.
Well, isn't this book an outside event?
Yes, it's hardly a major one. I don't think that my book will affect the fluctuations here.
So far as you know, will any notice of it be taken? For instance, does Rudenko read English?
No, but we hope to have a Russian edition.
And how will you distribute it? Some is that?
I hope that it's going to be small enough to fit in the pocket. Yes, samizdats too. There is a wide and surprising circulation of literature that the regime there would regard as subversive, and indeed, our only first-hand knowledge of the records in these cases came from samizdat distributions that by one means or another were smuggled out. I myself have had one letter from one of our prisoners in the Soviet Union, which got out I don't know how, and was forwarded to me through Israel, so that the thing is not 100% tight.
Mr. Sam Roberts is with the New York Daily News. Mr. Roberts?
You've said in one of your articles that laws governing criminal procedure in the Soviet Union do have enlightened safeguards. What are some of those that differ from ours? How often are they practiced, or are they just eliminated in state security cases? And what would happen if an American system of justice was imposed on the Soviet Union?
Well, you can't impose a system of justice. As a matter of fact, the provisions that I described as enlightened are on paper enlightened. They don't differ very radically from ours. They have the same kinds of guarantees that you're entitled to a lawyer of your own choosing, that the trial should be public, that all information relied on shall be given in open court. All those things are written into the Soviet Code of Criminal Procedure.
You can compel testimony in behalf of yourself, too, can't
sure,
you?
Yes. It says you have the right to call witnesses and all that kind of thing. You could find virtually every provision of the Bill of Rights in there, with only a few exceptions. Of course, long before Bolshevism, the system there was a continental legal system, more like the French, what we call the inquisitorial rather than the adversary system. They don't have a presumption of innocence. They don't have the right of the accused to testify under oath, but these are characteristics of continental law generally rather than the Soviet Union in particular. Well, now, what did you ask me about imposing our
system? Well, what would happen if it were imposed by an outside force, but if the Soviet Union adopted a system of criminal justice similar to ours? What effect would it have on
Soviet
society?
Well, as I say, on paper, the system isn't very different, and therefore the difference wouldn't be very marked if that were all that happened. If you're really asking what would happen if they gave weight to these provisions in political cases, why, I think the answer
would
be indicative of a change in the whole society, in the whole regime, which would be far more extensive than this one thing. This couldn't happen without a revolution in the attitude of the whole government about the judicial process. That the judicial process is not merely an engine of state policy, but that has to follow some, what my colleague Herbert Wexler would call, neutral principles. If the guarantee is going to be observed, it will be observed whatever the state's interest is in the outcome of that trial. That they do not have. I think I've put it in the book that the best test of the health of a judicial system is the way it responds to cases where there is official pressure for a certain outcome.
I assume that just based on everything you've said about the system that you don't really feel that there's anything the American system can learn from them, anything we could benefit from that they practice.
Certainly in terms of the legal procedures, that's generally true. I think it is quite possible that in terms of the availability of legal services to the poor, that they may be as well or better off than we are.
They're not supposed to have any poor.
What they do, as you know. They have many poor, probably many, many more than we do. And I don't think that in terms of getting representation, getting access to the system, that the poor are as disadvantaged here as there as here.
Talking about civil or criminal proceedings?
Well, both.
Long as there's no state interest involved.
As long as there's no strong state interest involved, yes. I would temper that again by saying that undoubtedly there are local problems and local briberies and local favoritisms there too, but that doesn't represent general state policy.
Ms. Lila Colburn is with Legal Action Center. Ms. Colburn.
Mr. Taylor, I'm wondering if you feel that the Soviet state interest in political trials distorts the judicial process there in a way different from the distortions that we observe here with
yes.
an interest in political trials.
I do feel it distorts them differently. I think here the distortions are much more likely to be eccentric and occasional. We do have them here and have them very badly from time to time. But I think there they are systematic. If I could use an analogy from the war crimes field, the charges against the German criminals were almost all the result of orders that came down from above and were generally distributed, and what was done was in accordance with a state systematic policy. The Japanese was quite the other way. There were hardly any cases where the criminal liability was based on an order from the top. It was much more a matter of what was the nature of the local commandant's personality. It was a thing which varied locally and by the individual. And I think that's much more the case with us here, that most of the abuses have been have been not the result of an official state policy which is of a systematic nature. That's not always true. I mean, we can find abuses that were certainly the result of official action.
Can you give a recent example?
A recent or recent?
No. I assume any example you give would be recent.
I will try.
Yeah, would you give, say, a conspicuous example of where the state interference with justice resulted in a manifestly tendentious proceeding?
Well, there have been quite a few cases where, under law, the defendant is entitled to get access to certain government documents where it has first been denied they exist and then one way or another has come out that they do exist, sometimes come out too late, sometimes in time. But the record of the government in following these procedures under what's called the Jenks Act and other sources have been by no means perfect.
Well, yeah, the Jenks, been other harassments. The Jenks ruling of the Warren Court is relatively recent, 10 years.
About 10 years, yes. Well, I thought we were talking about recent matters.
Well, no, I thought we were talking about a scandal.
Well,
As I understood the question, it is that isn't there in the United States something comparable to the kind of thing that you went over in the Soviet Union?
If you mean comparable in quantity, frequency, and virulence, I would say no. If you mean that there is the same germ there and it occasionally germinates, why, yes.
Well, the germ is presumably biological to seek to affect things in such a way as is pleasing to you. And if you have power, you exercise it. God knows Earl Warren felt that urge. But I think that Ms. Coltman was really asking whether or not we have political injustice built into our legal system. Is that correct?
Oh, that's a part of my question, yes. Yeah.
No, we don't have it built in.
That's what I hoped you would say.
Well, that's a particularly that's a particularly sanguine view.
But of course,
isn't
it? It doesn't have to be built in to be there from time to time.
No, and of course, it can be there in odd ways. I happen to think it was very much there in the case of Angela Davis, only it worked against the government. So very often, Jerry Rubin, sitting in this room a week ago, said that they went down to Chicago precisely to do that, which they were finally exonerated from being guilty of after a 7-month trial, whatever it was. Anyway, Mr. Kramer is from Moore Magazine.
Professor Taylor, I was interested in your exploring, if you will, what security interest the Soviet Union really feels it has in restricting Soviet immigration. Is it a question of sheer numbers, or what are they afraid of?
They're afraid, I think, of two things. One is they're afraid it will spread and spread and spread. If you examine the areas from which most of the most Jewish emigration has been allowed, it's not from the central areas, it's from the peripheral areas that are not Great Russian, White Russia, the Ukraine, the Caucasus, and so forth. And the emigrants, by and large, have not been technically trained people who, to put it crudely, are of high value to the state technically or intellectually. They do not want to see the lure of Israel spread to new areas or spread to higher scientific and intellectual circles where it will be damaging to the reservoir of ability there, which, after all, is a narrower reservoir of ability than we have. This is one of their...
So they're worried about a brain drain.
Yes, precisely. Now, the Leningrad people were, indeed, they were young. They were not famous scientists, but they were all trained people with good futures in the technical professional areas. They don't want those things to happen. The other thing, of course, I suppose is more ideological, that they feel that any loyalties strong enough to pull people away from the Soviet Union are dangerous to the Soviet idea, that any good Soviet citizen ought to want to stay. Mm-hmm. And therefore, anything that suggests discontent that moves one to get out of there, they regard as dangerous, basically dangerous. And of course, the Jews are not the only ones that they are worried about on this. There are other dissidents there. These abuses in the trials are not peculiar to the Jewish trials. They occur in other state trials, too.
What is the incidence of application for exit visas among non-Jews?
I don't know the answer to that. I really don't.
Would you suspect that it's high?
I don't think it's anything like as high as among the Jews. And that, of course, has been in part, though only in part, the result of the Near East situation, the 67 war, the more recent war, which unquestionably has spread a greatly increased Jewish consciousness in Jewish circles in the Soviet Union.
You talked before about the difference of opinion among Soviet leaders regarding this question or any other. Do you think that the restrictive policy now is a function of the Brezhnev regime that might change just because of internal factors without external pressure? Is it a question of personality?
Requires insights into the higher levels of the regime that I simply don't have. I would think on this sort of thing that they are more responsive to political shifts and other things. That if hostility between the Soviet Union and Egypt should eventually, for some reason, result in a reorientation of Soviet policy in the area, they might feel that they should change, establish relations with Israel and so forth. It's very hard to foresee that that far, isn't it?
Well, with a person as important as Rodenko, should he, for example, miraculously be elevated to the position of General Secretary, do you detect on his part any underlying philosophical sympathy with this problem?
No. Our conversation was friendly and courteous. We had been closely associated and in a personal sense liked each other perfectly well. And we had 10 or 15 minutes talking about, you know, reminiscing who's dead and who wasn't dead and so forth. But basically, as soon as it came to business, he was as hard and unresponsive as I had expected he would be. Quite frankly, I never expected to get in there in the first place, despite my prior acquaintance with him. Had you written him? Yes, I had written. I hadn't had any answer to the letters. The first time I went, he was ill, and I saw his deputy. There is a very interesting passage in Sakharov's book, not his last book, but the one before the last, in which he recounts his interview with Malyarov, who is the deputy, who is another very tough nut. I thought tougher than Rodenko. Rodenko is getting elderly, and I didn't find him well equipped to get into a discussion of these things on a close basis. Malyarov is a much tougher man.
And likely to succeed?
I was told by another Soviet friend that he was too old to be likely to succeed. He is 2 or 3 years younger than Rodenko, which means that he must be in his late 60s.
I see.
Of course, I don't any longer regard that as being very old. That's another matter.
Mr. Roberts?
Especially in the light of recent political activities in the United States involving the court system, whether it's disclosures of illegal activity involved in intelligence gathering, or whether it was the Chicago 7 trial, which could be interpreted as political from either perspective.
Yeah.
What is the Soviet view of American justice? I mean, do they share your view that there are not any political constraints institutionalized and that it functions smoothly, or especially people who have studied it, not just the man in the street?
I think it would be hard to find anybody who would say that. There are a number of Soviet lawyers who have been here, who came into contact with American jurists at Nuremberg and other conferences. Some of them are more flexible in discussion than others, but I think they would all take the party line, so to speak, that here the judicial system is dominated by corporate and financial interests, that it's responsive to class questions rather than to any considerations of abstract justice, which they would say is a smokescreen to conceal its real purposes. That's what you would get.
Did you have any objective discussions with any Soviet lawyers or jurists at all?
Not in these trips, no. I guess I'd have to say no, never. But objective is a word with many shades, and some conversations were less unobjective than others.
Well, did you run into any of them who backed the Jackson Amendment?
No.
Did you find that it was a fighting word with most of the people you ran into?
No. The last conversations I've had on this came after the Jackson Amendment had been dropped, and they were talking about it in a rather humorous and scornful way on the whole.
But it wasn't actually dropped. The trade deal was dropped.
Well, that's what I mean, yes.
What was the personal and professional reaction to your active intervention on the part of colleagues in the Soviet Union? Was it a sense of why not go back and clean up your own house, or why are you meddling? Or do you think that there was not a backlash but actually some positive impact?
On these trips, I took pains to stay away from from any other contacts. After all, my primary purpose as a lawyer there was to get relief for a certain number of people. I did not see any dissidents. I did not see any Jews. I kept very much to myself in order to make it clear that I was there for one purpose only, and this was not tied up with anti-Sovietism in general or with Jewish emigration. This is a professional matter to show them that they had violated their own laws in these cases and they ought to fix it up. And for those reasons, I eschewed any opportunity to pursue those things.
Well, do you think that we would have been as receptive or unreceptive had a group of Soviet attorneys come and done the same thing in a case here, be it the Chicago 7 trial or whatever?
It's a good question. I can only guess.
But they do it, in effect.
But to make an actual personal pilgrimage rather than any kind of propaganda tirade or anything.
I can only say that if I were Attorney General and such a delegation came, I would certainly not turn them away from my door. I would want to know what they would say and what they had, and I would receive them. I might well disagree with them, that's quite another matter. That sort of thing hasn't happened much, but as Mr. Buckley was saying a minute ago, in other ways they do indeed come. You look back to the Rosenberg trial and the amount, the volume of material that came into this country then saying the death sentence should be suspended. In its way, simply another way of doing what we're trying to do by these techniques.
Or in the case of in the recent case of Spain and the five terrorists, there were delegations all over the place, and ambassadors withdrawn, all kinds of activity. I think that we've taken, certainly the our representatives in the United Nations have taken a position that we're receptive to any evidence garnered anywhere on the subject of American injustice. After all, we imported a Swede to tell us about the situation in the South.
A delegation from the Soviet Union coming here in our cases would have a very much easier time than I did, because our court records are open. They can get the records, which we had to rely primarily on these few samizdats that had been smuggled out, plus what we could get orally from the relatives. This, incidentally, is quite a curious feature of the whole situation. Despite the nature of these trials, the Soviet authorities have allowed the relatives to go to Israel, and at the conclusion of their terms, they have allowed the prisoners to go. And they were the main source of our first-hand information about the trials.
Ms. Coburn?
Mr. Taylor, you said that we might take a leaf from the Russians' book on making available legal services to all segments of the population. Could you elaborate a bit on the mechanisms that are used there to make legal services available more generally than here?
I don't know how it's handled financially, but I have never heard of any situation where money stood in the way of someone getting a lawyer and getting access to the courts there. I perhaps spoke too hastily in venturing that opinion at all, but I believe that the socialist nature of the profession there, its close contact with the state, has resulted in obligation to take cases, whether the person is able to pay or not, which works much more broadly than our legal services, our legal aid societies, and so forth.
Again, you're talking about criminal cases now.
Criminal and civil.
Civil,
yes. Yeah.
I mean, you can force a lawyer to handle your libel complaint, say, or?
I don't know whether they have libel complaints.
Breach of contract?
That's a breach of, and of course they don't have many private contracts. There must be all that kinds takes, of.
They don't have many automobile wrecks, are they?
Not too many.
They don't have any automobiles.
Well, they have more automobile wrecks per automobile
yeah,
than we
right,
do.
Yeah, they do. ten times as many.
They don't drive as well, as carefully.
What status do lawyers occupy in Soviet society?
Not too high. Not too high. I think they regard this as a very secondary contribution to socialist welfare.
And a little bourgeois in Providence.
Well, of course, it is bourgeois in Providence,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
But I think they simply, they think that for curious reasons that I don't understand, they also look down on doctors, rather. That is not regarded as the equivalent of physicists and...
that may be because they only give them about 9 months' training.
Professor Taylor, I just wanted to ask you about your the example you mentioned before about the judge.
Yes.
There was a woman judge who sat on this case and was later
mm-hmm.
allowed to emigrate. How does that square with the brain drain? Was she a particularly bad judge?
Well, the ordinary Soviet court, which hears these cases, is composed of one professional judge and two what they call lay assessors. These are people from the community who are not lawyers. This is part of the idea that the judicial process ought to be a people's process. Therefore, the tribunal is not exclusively professional. They have two lay people and one professional jurist, who in fact pretty much dominates the scene. And the lady in question had been one of the lay assessors, and she was allowed to emigrate later. It seems to me a little odd. I don't know how it all came about that way. And it was only by chance that we found her in Israel when we got there. We hadn't been told in advance, but we saw some of Pinkasov's relatives, and they had heard about it, so we found her, and she was quite prepared to give these statements.
Well, how do you become a lay assessor?
I guess that this is a little bit like being on the jury here. They must have lists of citizens that they regard as suitably secure politically to serve on cases such as this. And she was one such. She told us that she had served on several others before. So I think she must have been a person who is in generally the good graces of the local authorities and had been called upon.
Professional lay assessor or something.
Yeah.
Like that.
Yes. Well, we have professional jurymen too, you know.
Yeah.
They like the free lunches and the small fees that jurymen get.
But that process more closely resembles an arbitration panel or something in an American system.
Well, except that it is dominated by the professional judge, so that it I'm sure, is very directly responsive to official pressures, which are usually exerted through the KGB.
Well, they're more like a military court-martial, perhaps, where the
they have those too, and we know very little about those, because those are even less public than the so-called public trials.
When an American lawyer goes over there, as, for instance, Adlai Stevenson did, to try to get them to recognize the copyright laws,
yeah.
Does he do so by invitation, or is by sufferance, or is there some international convention by which he can represent an international case?
I don't think there's any such international convention. I don't know about Stevenson, but Harold Berman, who's the Russian specialist at the Harvard Law School, is, so far as I know, the only American lawyer who has indeed been allowed to actually appear in court in the Soviet Union.
Was he the one who defended our U2 guy?
No. He was over there in the copyright business that you just mentioned. And he was allowed to appear in the Soviet Supreme Court and and argue the case for American copyright interests. He speaks Russian and was able to do it in propria persona.
I see. Well, thank you very much, Professor Taylor. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the panel. And thank you, students from Fordham Preparatory School.
Thank you all for listening to me.
Printed bound transcript of this program, send $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's $1 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Production funding provided by public television stations, the Ford Foundation, and the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.